Over the last week, I've been seeing a lot of talk online about how OpenAI's competitor to Claude Code, Codex CLI, has become really good. And I'll be comparing both in this video. But to show you what I mean, this person over here, they said they needed to mock up some complex interactions in a graph model, and they gave it to Codex CLI and it hit 90% coverage 15 minutes later. Claude never got past more than 10% on Opus. This person over here, they said that GPT-5 high with Codex CLI is really good when it comes to Swift UI development. It one-shots insanely complicated asks. And there's been a couple of people talking about it as well on Twitter and also on Reddit if you scroll down. There have been some big updates to Codex CLI recently, one of them being that ChatGPT Plus users now get 50% increased usage limits. And some people have also been saying that Codex CLI crawls their codebase to a degree that they've never seen before from Claude Code. And with a lot of the other discussion that's happening, I think my expectations here are pretty high. So I'll be using both Claude Code and Codex CLI to implement 3 different features across 3 different production codebases. This video is not sponsored by anyone. I don't accept sponsors because I don't want to bias my videos in a particular direction, but it is made possible by the people who do buy my AI tools and products using the links and coupon codes in the description down below. The first thing we'll be doing is editing my AI news application, Tensor AI. It's 100% free and basically helps stay up to date with the latest AI news. Recently, it became the number one app for the AI news keyword on the US App Store. So there's a link in the description to download it if you're interested in it. But basically, we'll be improving the recommended notifications to use embeddings instead, because I add embeddings for user interests and also the articles as well. Next, we'll be editing my advanced, highly customizable frontend for LLMs called MindDeck to add MCP servers. There's a coupon code down below if you're interested. And then finally, we'll be doing something related to Swift UI, because this person said that GPT-5 High with Codex CLI is really good for Swift UI. And this is my speech-to-text application, HyperWhisper, and I basically want to make some improvements to design. There's a coupon code down below for that as well. Both MindDeck and HyperWhisper are single licenses, so you only have to purchase it once. There's no recurring subscription. Firstly, you want to make sure you have Codex CLI installed by using npm install, and then make sure on the latest version. And then you can just run Codex and then link it to your ChatGPT account. And then you should see a welcome to Codex. Now, Codex CLI does use an agents.md file, so I basically cloned the claude.md file to be an agents.md file as well. And I'll be running the same command in 2 different folders that have the exact same codebase. Anyways, I'll use my tool HyperWhisper to transcribe my instructions by saying, hey, basically I want you to add the ability where when recommendations are made to a user based on their interests, like the notifications are sent to a user, then instead of using GPT-5 Nano, it should use the article embeddings and the user interest embeddings instead. I have a super-based function that already does this for the For You feed. I want you to be able to make a similar function that gets articles that are relevant to user after a particular creator that, and then uses those to recommend articles for the user. Likewise, you should also update the roundup that happens daily and weekly, and do roundups using a brand new superbase function that uses those embeddings as well. Basically, I want you to remove ChatGPT or GPT-5 Nano completely from the codebase when it comes to making recommendations. And now it's written everything out over here, so I'll copy this over and paste into Codex CLI. And now I'll press enter on both and we'll see how they perform. All right, so both of them are done for this particular task. Claude is still going around in circles, and that's because of a bug in Superbase when it comes to migrations. So let's quickly look for the code. Codex CLI's code is on the left and Claude Code is on the right over here. Now the solutions are pretty much the same for the Superbase function. They both do 16 comparisons when it comes to distance between the vectors and choose the greatest value. But the Codex CLI one is slightly faster because it handles the nulls, which will appear when they don't have enough interest embeddings. So I actually prefer this one over here, and because it also has a filter article IDs, which I didn't realize that I wanted, but is useful. But despite that, Codex CLI doesn't seem to have written the second function that I hoped for, whereas Claude Code did write a second function. So maybe the implementation is slightly different here. And now comparing the solutions and notifications themselves, for Codex CLI, there does seem to be a small type error over here that I can fix quite easily by moving this. And the rest of it looks pretty good. Codex CLI did implement a filter articles ID in the Superbase function itself, whereas Claude Code does the filtering after and using a set over here. So I think Codex ELIs is slightly more efficient, but they both get the same job done at the end of the day. And as for creating the roundups themselves, Codex ELI does use the same one function that I wrote before, whereas Cloud Code uses the other function that I wrote. So it wrote two Superbase functions, and I actually don't know which one I prefer over here. It's quite nice that Codex ELI is efficient and it is not making multiple unnecessary functions that it may not need to. Whereas it seems that Cloud Code did actually follow my instructions more clearly and did make a separate function which has different logic with a minimum and a maximum match count. But I think for this particular step, I do prefer Cloud Code's solution. It is still nice to know that Codex ELI does seem to be quite efficient when it comes to thinking about the best way of implementing something, especially when it comes to performance though. But yeah, I think I'll actually be mixing the two solutions together in this particular case. And now next up, I'm going to be editing MindDeck over here. I'm going to be allowing users to add their own custom MCP servers and use from the existing MCP server templates. And basically in MindDeck, you can have many different chats in parallel to many different LLM providers. You can use any provider that's available on OpenRouter, which is literally hundreds of providers in parallel. There are nested subchats as well. And everything happens locally, so your API keys that you enter are stored locally on your device. There is no backend. And you can see this yourself by going to Inspect and then going to Network. And then if you say something like hi to your chat, then you can see your device makes requests directly to the OpenAI endpoint. There is no backend that's like funneling all your requests, which means that's privacy first as well. And if you want to, then you can import your chats from ChatGPT. And I personally use it every single day across literally thousands of different chats that I have. I'm always adding it to it, and there's a coupon code linked down below for the one-time purchase that it is. Anyways, I'll be using HyperWhisper to describe the changes that I want. Hey, so basically I want you to add a new section of the website, kind of like the models section, which allows users to add their own MCP servers. There should be some pre-built, pre-added MCP servers, mainly the Twavely one, whose documentation that I'm about to give you. But you should allow the user to add their own MCP servers with their own headers and URLs and so forth. And those MCP servers are injected into the OpenAI responses API that is being used. I'm going to give you the documentation for that as well, of how that should be combined together. You should also add a model for this as well to store the MCP servers that the user has added in Dexy. Annoyingly enough, when you start a new Codex session, then it switches back to GPT-5 Medium, so you have to switch back to GPT-5 High, and I'll do that. And I'll also get it to search online because I'm quite interested in how good its searching capabilities are. At least with a recent paper from Salesforce AI Research called MCP Universe, GPT-5 is really good at web searching compared to Claude 4 Sonnet. Claude 4 Opus is not on here, but I imagine it wouldn't be much better than Claude 4 Sonnet. If OpenAI Codex did have a planning mode, then I would use a planning mode right now, but since it doesn't, I won't use a planning mode for either agent. One thing I do want to mention when I'm watching these models work is that Codex has a really strange way of searching the internet. Firstly, it uses Google over here, and then later it switches to DuckDuckGo for some reason. And then later, it tries to do it via Python over here, and using like requests. And yeah, it's really interesting watching it go. Okay, so it seems that both of them are done. Codex CLI did use more tokens as well. It used 130,000 tokens, whereas Cloud Code used 72,000 tokens. So I expect more tokens. It probably got more context from online or something. So I'm hoping the solution will be better, but we'll see right now. So I'll run both of them. Here is a one from Codex CLI first, and it has an MCP tab over here. It has a list of MCP servers. So it has Twavely twice. It has a add MCP server over here. So let's actually check if the MCP server works properly. So I'm going to have to add my API key. And yeah, it's quite nice to add an icon URL over here as well. And it lets me delete some of these default servers too. But now the sidebar has disappeared, so that needs to be added back. So now that's loaded, we can have it search online and check. So we can say who won the first FIFA World Cup, search online. And then using the responses API, it should search online, hopefully. And I should really add a thinking thing. So did it actually get the information online? We can check the response. And yeah, you can see the MCP tool call was made over here. I wish it updated the UI as well, but I should have told it in my instructions to update the UI. But you can see the MCP tool call was made using the API key that I provided to Twavely, and then it searched with Twavely, and then got the information like that. So overall, I am really impressed with the solution that I gave. Although I wish, just like in the model section, you have the sidebar over here, it had the sidebar in the MCP tab over here, and it like kind of copied the design over because it seems to have come up with a slightly different like padding, color scheme, and design. But yeah, as for the underlying logic, it works really well. And now this is the one that Claude Code gave us, so we can go to MCP servers. It did copy the design over, like the design is very similar to the one in models over here. It did add two Twavely servers as well. I'm not sure why it added two. And there's a nice on button, off button. I wish it allowed me to delete them because there are two of them, but I guess can delete them somewhere else maybe. And Claude Code does seem to have a better distinction between the built-in servers and the custom servers as well, compared to at least Codex CLI solution. And it has a tool approval mode, which is really good because actually, Codex CLI did not implement a tool approval mode. So I wonder if it added some front-end logic for tool approval as well. But anyway, make sure the server is active, update server, and let's try a new chat and enter our OpenAI key. And now we can open it up in Inspect Element, go to Network over here, press New Chat, and then enter in the same message about the FIFA World Cup, and then see if the responses API actually searches online. So it has been provided with the MCP tool over here. And if I search the event stream, if I search MCP, then it actually is using the MCP tool. So you can see it's being returned in the event stream over here. And yeah, overall, both of them implemented a working solution, which is really good. I do prefer the design of the one that Claude Code gave when it comes to the MCP servers page, because it copied over the existing design and it considered things such as the tool approval, which Codex CLI did not consider, even though Codex CLI did use more tokens. But something that I do like about Codex CLI is that it gave a nice questions for you section over here. And it said, like, here are some next steps that I can quickly take. And this is a thing that I noticed with GPT-5 in general. Whenever it ends a message, it usually has some kind of like follow-up question or just something that it can do later on. And I wonder how good of a job Claude Code really did. So if I go to the servers and then go to the tool approval and then change it to always over here, press update, and then see if like it does ask me a permission. How about the following World Cup? Press enter. Now it should ask me for permission, hopefully. And the message like disappeared. I think that's because the UI has to be updated in some way, so I'll tell Claude Code to do that. But overall, I do actually prefer Claude Code solution over a Codex solution, mostly because of the UI differences, and I think it did a better job with your tokens as well. Okay, now we'll be moving on to HyperWhisper. There is a coupon code down below for lifetime access to this if you do want it. But basically, when you see it right now, the design is kinda like basic in the sense there is a fast Fourier transform being applied to your voice as you're speaking, and there's kind of like a rainbow that's like swashing back and forth as you're speaking. And I kind of want a design that looks slightly more like this over here. So there's kind of like waves, and these waves go up and down, and there's like a neon like glow around the waves or something like that. Basically, I'm going to pass it the screenshot, and then I'm going to see how well each of the models do when it comes to updating the UI for this. Okay, turns out you can't just paste an image into Codex CLI. You have to attach this like image command over here and then give it the file path. So I'm going to do that right now. So now I'll just type out the prompt and say, hey, so basically I want you to update the audio visualizer for this application. Currently, I'm using a fast Fourier transform and showing the peaks and the waves as the user speaking. I want to update the design to use this kind of design in this image instead. It should be like kind of a neon waves with glow surrounding them. They should be able to go both up and down, not just up. And yeah, see what you come up with. So now I'll copy over this prompt to here as well, and then press enter, and then press enter over here. So this was slightly annoying because you can't just drag and drop an image. It has to be there with like the initial prompt. And it seems that someone did open up a new pull request on GitHub adding the feature to drag and drop images, which hopefully goes through. But yeah, I think overall, Codex CLI does not have as good functionality built in by default. It's like very limited in the amount of features that it has right now. Okay, so both of them are done. Cloud Code took 54,000 tokens, whereas Codex CLI took 50,000 tokens, so around about the same. But the tokens would be priced differently if you are using the API instead of having a monthly subscription, so that's worth taking into consideration as well. Anyway, we can use Xcode to then run both of them. We'll start off with the Codex one. Alright, so this is what the Codex one looks like. So if I press this, then allow to my microphone. It looks pretty interesting. It does have the neon effect, and it does kind of like move and react to what I'm saying. You can see it like kind of dies down as I stop speaking. But I don't like these small bumps that are going across it. It's strange. But I think the effect is very cool. I'm actually quite interested or excited to see what Cloud Code came up with. And then press Control Shift I. And yeah, Cloud Code did not do as good of a job, certainly, when it comes to Swift UI. I think I'm going to hand it to GPT-5 for this one. So I think the tweet that I mentioned earlier, where this person was saying that GPT-5 high for Swift UI was really great, was actually correct. So I think I'm going to iterate on that design with GPT-5 high and make it look better, and then update the application. And of course, if you want to use application, then you can download it using the coupon code and the link in the description down below. Like with the other application, your requests go directly to OpenAI, so any post-processing that happens on the audio or the speech-to-text of the audio itself is done by OpenAI, but you can also download any of these models offline. So if you go to the model list over here, then you can see these are all different Whisper-sized models, and you can download bigger and smaller ones and multilingual ones depending on your own use cases, and then you can create modes out of them. Like, I have a Japanese mode over here. And of course, you can switch between the modes and so forth. I'll continue to add more features to it, and I think I will continue to use GPT-5 for this particular use case because it seems good at Swift UI. But I think for the other use cases, when it comes to Next.js especially, like I did with MindDeck, I will continue to use Cloud Code. It's quite interesting that each model kind of has its own strengths and weaknesses. But I think overall, I will continue to be using Cloud Code because just the CLI experience is still better right now. They have more features. Things just work out of the box. In the sense, like the images thing, I had to do this like crazy workaround. Sometimes when it asks me, do you want to approve permissions to use like curl or something, and I select always, then it doesn't stay as always. The model keeps changing back to medium every time I start a new Codex session. So I think Codex CLI does need a lot of improvement still. I think it will actually be really good in a couple months from now, but I think we're starting to see where different coding models are better suited towards slightly different things. So some people will have multiple coding agents. They might use GPT-5 when it comes to some kind of design work, and they might use Cloud Code for bigger tasks, or they might want to like optimize their costs in some way. I don't think there will be an overall one winner, at least not for the next year or so. I think each model will still have its own strengths and weaknesses. But for me, my overall conclusion is that when I'm editing a web project on Next.js, then I will be using Cloud Code. When I'm editing any Swift or Swift UI applications, then I will be using GPT-5 High. And I'll probably also be using GPT-5 High to solve any bugs that Cloud Code could not solve, and to make any performance improvements, because it seems to be able to write more efficient code from the start. But yeah, hopefully that video wasn't too long and it was interesting. If you do like this kind of stuff, then do subscribe, because it means that I should be making more of this, and it will let the algorithm know this is a good video as well. And as I've said earlier, I've never accepted a sponsor on this channel, but I still need to be able to pay like OpenAI and Cloud Code and everything else to make videos for you guys. So if you do want to support the channel, then you can buy any of the AI tools that I make and use myself in the description down below. There should be some coupon codes as well that give you a bit of a discount, and you would be supporting the channel as well.